welcome everyone. Before I introduce Mr. Prix, I would like to acknowledge our lecture series, in which we are fortunate to bring some of the most brilliant architects around the world to our school. And I think this is something from an educational perspective is something that it's invaluable for us. It's a great opportunity that we are really grateful for. So today we are going to have Mr. Wolf Prix from Coop Himmelb, Vienna, that's going to give a lecture on the project HIMMELBLAU. And then the following weeks, we are going to have Antoine Picon from Harvard. We are going to have Patrick Schumacher from Zaadid, and Daniel Adams afterwards. So like I said, it's an honor for me to welcome and introduce Mr. Wolf Prix, who is here from Vienna. And I think everyone is really excited to have him here. So just to give a short background about Coop Himmelb, so his office Coop Himmelb was founded in 1968, and translated Coop Himmelb would be Blue Skies Cooperative, also known as Building the Skies. But we have to understand that Coop Himmelb is not the color, but an idea of creating architecture with fantasy and buoyant and variable as clouds. So Mr. Prix's career began in a way as a sort of art practice with Helmut Zwierzynski for a very long time, where they were setting up installations or would roll these kind of large plastic balls around Vienna. And probably you are going to see some of those projects too today. And then in the 70s, there was a turn in towards architecture mostly, with the project Falkenstrassen rooftop project. So from 83 on, Wolf Prix became more notorious throughout through the deconstructivist exhibition put on by Philip Johnson at MoMA, and along with other architects as Peter Eisenman, Frank Gehry, Zaha Hadid, Rem Koolhaas, Daniel Libeskind, Bernard Tsumi, and all these architects will prove to be some of the most influential architects in the late 20th century and early 21st century. And from there on, you can say that everything is history, as Coop Himmelb started to really build large projects, very large and complex projects all around the world, such as Mocape in Saint-Jean, Museum de Confluence in Lyon, Dalian Conference Center, BMW-Welt in Munich, and many, many other that we are really privileged today to have Mr. Prix showing those projects. So Mr. Prix also held like various very important teaching positions. One of his most important international teaching position was his tenure at University of Applied Arts in Vienna, where from 2003 to 2012, he was also a vice rector and the head of the Institute of Architecture. So his teaching roles are extensive. He also was a visiting professor at a London, Harvard University, MIT. I think he's one of the most important figures when it comes to this University of Applied Arts program that became something unique in the world. So I would also like to welcome Mr. Prix as a sort of mentor for myself, as a former boss, and as somebody that I really respect in terms of his willingness to take risks on all levels, not only with work, but also with the office. So this willingness to take risk, I believe, is something that is absolutely crucial to the kind of work you can produce and the difference you can make in architecture. As a former designer and computational design specialist at Coop Himmelb, I cannot overstate the impact that Mr. Prix had on my professional development. His philosophy, architectural thinking, leadership style, open-mindedness combined with a very sharp critique. So all these were a sort of breeding ground for what's going to be also presented today as the project Himmelblau, and lately also the Himmelblau project, which is currently one of the most advanced research in the world dealing with AI, deep learning in architectural design. So his way of leading the office and his educational philosophy was something that influenced me back when I started working with Coop Himmelb, and it still influences me today in the way I run my design studios. So I will end this intro with a quote from Anton Desson that describes clearly in a way Mr. Prix's impact and also his way of thinking when it comes to certain aspects of the office and teaching. And the quote reads as follows: "If you want to build a ship, do not drum up the men to gather wood, divide the work and give orders. Instead, teach them to yearn for the vast and endless sea." That being said, it's my honor to introduce Mr. Prix, and please join me in welcoming Mr. Prix.
Thank you. Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Thank you very much, Daniel, for making me so old. I feel like a very old architect now, but as you know, experience is one of the tools of doing architecture. So I feel like a young architect now. You know that Otto Wagner, I think it was Otto Wagner who said that, Frank Lloyd Wright, who said that you become an architect with 60. So I'm a very young architect. I have an 18-year-old architect now, anyway. So thank you for the invitation. I put 2 hours ago, I decided to do a completely different lecture than I was thinking of. And I will not do a workshop talk. I'm not talking about how we use programs. I'm talking about methods we used in order to change the way of thinking in architecture, meaning that we are not believing in architects and architectural theory at all. We say if you think too much in architectural terms, only architecture will come out, which was at our beginning really no-no. So not a workshop talk, but I will show you, like the title announced, how our design method changed and how the architecture we are doing changed along the new method we developed from year to year, so to say. Okay. Doesn't work. Please. I need Jan. I'm wondering how an airplane could fly with all this computer stuff if we cannot handle a computer. And the AI, I don't think will become a very, very successful tool in the reality of architecture. But this may be in 20 years, but this is not my... I cannot change the... Let me...
Are we waiting for Jan or?
I think the whole thing is broken again. Oh, I really hate that. This is working.
Yes.
I don't know how I can change the pictures. Hold on a second. I need my co-pilot. The original name was Building Cooperative Himmelblau, which means that we always were interested in bringing our ideas into reality. We were not going for sophisticated theory. We were trying to make architecture to an architecture which only speaks in terms of space. And in the next step, yeah. And one of our key sentences is, ich hab's es geht. Our key sentence was along to this very famous book in the 60s, The Open Society and Their Enemies. Everybody is right, but nothing, really nothing is correct. That's a very important measure for the changes in society from an absolute society to a democratic society. If we talk about architecture, we only talk about this visible part of an iceberg. This visible part contains all the theory and all blah, blah. But the more important thing is the invisible part of an iceberg, because this, like you could see that on the example of the Titanic, it was crashed by the invisible part, which means politics, economics, social distancing, and the aesthetics, and so forth, and so forth. Critics never think about this invisible architecture, which is, I would say, the more influential part to the outcome than the theory we can develop on our academic level. Es geht schon wieder nicht. Kann ich noch einmal den Jan haben? Titanic is a good example that this part is the more dangerous thing for all people who are concerned in architecture. Because as you know, people always, when we propose a project, the first question is not, oh, this is a beautiful project. They always say, how much will it cost and how long will it take?
Ich drück da drauf und es geht nicht weiter.
Ja, das geht nicht.
Jetzt geht's.
Ja, aber schon. Ja, zurück.
Mhm.
Warum geht es, wenn ich länger rede, nochmal geht es nie? Ja? We always forget that sustainability has three levels, not only the ecological level or the economic level. There's a third level, which is the most important level in my point of view. This is the social aspect and the art. Therefore, we started to introduce art and all the other things which have nothing to do at the first glimpse with architecture into our way of thinking when we started Coop Himmelblau. Es geht schon wieder nicht, Jan. I'm sorry. I need a co-pilot, I have to see. Now you can study the three levels more carefully. I'm waiting for my co-pilot again. Warum geht das? Aber du musst jetzt da bleiben, wenn du.
Ja, ja. So.
Ja. Warum geht es nicht weiter? We are living on a. Nowadays, we are living on a very uncertain ground. Nothing is for sure. Old structures are going to die, but they are not dead already. And new structures are not born now. But we can, and the school and all the thinking, they can do experiments which could maybe influence the upcoming new structure. This is very important. So the schools have a very important role. Wieso geht das nicht? Everyone knows this painting. very famous painting. How would Michelangelo paint this building nowadays? Maybe like this. Very, 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 very important, because we all believe that we are ruling these social networks and all these programs, but the truth is, the truth is that we are ruled by this system already. Think about Amazon and all these other guys who are ruling this. Gravity, you know, is not a power. Like Einstein said, gravity is the attitude of the space. For us, it's a very important fact, because all our projects we are doing, we integrate the gravity as a attitude of the upcoming projects we are planning. And not by chance, this, not by chance, you lie in the chair of Le Corbusier the same way that astronauts are lying in the space capsule when they overcome gravity. And since we are thinking in a gravity-less space, the monocentric perspectives will become obsolete. So the question is, what is architecture? And there's a very simple answer, yes. Our first project was concerned with the buildings for a new society which are free from all these constraints and restriction we are, have to operate with nowadays. It was a structure constructed by air with movable platforms where you can construct every space situation you want to have, or the inhabitants want to have. And from there on, we started our career. And we call in only 2 days, tomorrow is yesterday. Meaning we architects have to foresee the future in a very specific way, because when we start to a project, it takes 5 to 10 years until it's built. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
When we started our career in 68, we couldn't build the project. We had no commission at all. So we started to fantasize by sketching the ideas we had of a living environment we want to plan. But when I was doing the sketch, I was walking around the space I imagined, and my desire to build it was very big at this time. We started to sketch and build things where we can prove which material we wanted to do and how we can manipulate the materials when we will build a bigger building or a building. You know this, can you see my arrow? This part was mounted on the elevator so it could be moved up and down. Movable architecture. Or materials, the skin of the city was an object, a foley we did for a museum in Berlin, where we combined materials like this, glass, metal, and concrete parts. We studied it, how we can do it when we will get the first commission. This is the cloud I showed before, a sketch. You can see how the people are moving around in many different spatial situations, or like this. since I said we wanted to build things, we started to get sponsors, to get to build a space situation which we could imagine could improve the environment and the reception of environment. Villa Rosa was one of the first thing we built. It's a flexible living machine with movable space, and so forth. The last drawing I did with a pencil. I'm wearing this on my right shoulder as a tattoo. This was the last drawing I did with a pen. Since we were always thinking we had to change architecture immediately and very radical, we were thinking about what's the weakest point in the process of the development of architecture. And we thought that the moment of design is the weakest point, because it could be, it's deciding how the building will be. So therefore, we analyzed the word Entwerfen, which means design in German, and German is very precise in this case, much more precise than the English word design, because it refers to a subconscious procedure on one hand, and a very actual procedure. Werfen means to throw away, and it refers to an unconscious procedure, and werfen comes from to throw. And I compared this moment with a jumping whale. The whale is coming from a subconscious area, and changing the paradigms by leaving this water. And while he is doing that, the whale is doing that, 30 tons could fly. And without knowing what deconstructivist meaning at this time, we found out that we were one of the first deconstructivists, because this was done in the beginning of the 17. We started to experiment how we can influence the moment of designing, meaning saying that the moment of design is the moment where we can liberate space. And later on, we found out when we were invited to take part on the exhibition Deconstructivist Architect, we found out that it was common in the architectural scene to think about that. The deconstructivist term is coming from Derrida's philosophy, and to make a long story short, he's saying that the moment the writer is writing, the painter is painting, the composer is makes compositions. He in every text, in every painting, in every music piece, there is an unconscious written, painted, or composed moment which rules the whole text. This is very, very connected to Freud, which, you know, was a Viennese guy who said that the unconscious is ruling our and influencing our actions of the daily life. And since then, since we are Viennese and we are firm with all these theories, I feel really connected to this moment of designing. I feel that this deconstructivist thing is a very important thing for us, because in the moment you design, you can, if you make it very snappy, you can exclude all these prohibiting things, meaning all the things which prohibit the liberation of space, namely, you know, economic things, codes and rules, and so forth, and so forth. Money and what people always ask for at the first moment. If you can make it very snappy and let the unconscious rule your tools, meaning the drawing at this time, we can get rid of all this prohibiting and pressing things which makes architecture to a very boring thing. And this is an example, it's called the open house, and this was the first, I was trying to draw because I was a very routine drawer. I can draw with my, I tried to do it with my left hand, with burning the drawings just to find out which way would be the best way to exclude all these other things which really makes architecture to a conventional thing. And we got a client, a psychoanalyst in San Francisco. He called me up and said, I want you to design a house for me. And we were talking a lot. And I was talking with the client, and we were talking a lot with my partner Helmut at this time. And never thinking about spatial consequences. And one day I was really sure that I know how the building should look like, which contains all the wishes of the client and at the same time is a space which is not putting the wishes of the client in physical borderlines. I closed the eyes in order to, and used my hand as the seismograph of the feeling which I can imagine I will have when I step into this space. A very deconstructivist method. At the same time, my partner was building a model which was small like a matchbox. And then we developed this model by measuring all the mistakes we have in this model and transplanted into a drawing. Because the client wants us to build the house, which has no separated rooms, because we thought that the client should live in this volume and then decide where he wants to sleep, where he wants to live, and where he wants to read books and so forth. The plans were done, the model were done, everything were done. And I have to say, there is no column in this building. All the structure is a tensile structure because I don't like columns because columns take pressure. Tension structures are dynamic. They are almost moving. So we build a bigger model and then the client died and we never built this building. What we build at the same method, not with eyes closed, but the same method. This is the first sketch for the rooftop, which we built in Vienna, breaking all the building codes of the Viennese city at this time. Why we could do that? We brought the model to our mayor and he said, no, this is not architecture, that must be art. And I said, okay, if this is art, there is no, you cannot use building codes in order to check this building. Yeah, we built it. And I have to say, A lot of rules were broken, but it was working definitely very functional and very according to the safety load codes. Not that easy to build. While experimenting by doing a model measuring with a scale, I read a magazine saying that in LA for a movie, they had a method, they developed a method where they can digitize like a statue and copy it perfectly. And I thought I have to find out what this tool is. And I went to LA, met Frank Gehry, and he said, oh, this is a space. And next to my office, they have a space. I went there, bought the thing, and then we started to measure the model by the space. I'm digitizing it in three dimensions like that, and then we built it, and we built this museum not as a conventional building, but we did it in a shipyard, because at this time the shipyard had no work, and therefore it was cheaper than to make it conventional with a conventional brick and concrete construction. We built the museum like a ship, and you can see the inside. It's not a conventional exhibition space, which gave the curators always a hard time. But I always said it was not easy to make an exhibition in the Sixtine Chapel. Museum Confluence, space arm, and beginning the parametric, using parametric models, but the influence was rather a natural story. The point of departure was the area we had to build it is a peninsula, and two rivers come together. Therefore, they call it, it will be the Museum of Confluence. Floating together, not only the content will be hybrid, but we thought also the building has to be developed very hybrid, and we experimented the flow of two liquids coming together in order to find a new language to express this floating together. This is the space program. And one of the most important thing is the turbulences, which you can see if two rivers are floating together, and we took one turbulence and created a column out of it. And this column is supporting the glass cylinder, the entrance, the lobby of the theater. You will see it immediately, and you can see it that it's built, and it also serves to reduce the amount of steel, meaning to reduce the money to build, so we can do it and not create problems with the budget. This is always a problem if you do it extraordinary things. The other thing is that we always use in our buildings, and this is maybe a little difference to all my American friends, that we always introduce spirals, bridges, in order to cross the space. We cannot fly through the space, which is my ultimate dream. But if we can walk through the space in many dimensions, different dimensions, maybe you get more experience from the space than you if you go only on the floor and look up one of the columns. The funny thing is, I came after it was opened, I came to this column and saw this these handprints. And it reminded me on the cave paintings where people, in order to say this is mine, they put a handprint on the stone, and these people made it with oil or something like that. I liked it very much because it shows that even these things can be occupied, not only mentally, but also physically. And the other thing was, when we started to build it, I saw how complicated it was, that the workers putting partly to the surface in order to create this metal cloud. And I thought, okay, there must be another way how we can do that. And it would lead us immediately that we can do it also with robots. That was not possible at this time to introduce it in a regular building in Europe, but we could do it that in China. This is Leon, still Leon. Well, I really have to say that I don't like to look architecture only on a flat screen or on a drawing paper or a photograph. I think you can only judge architecture, if it's real architecture, if you go in and uses the fourth dimension, time, to experience architecture. Walking through a building can never be replaced by nothing, because your subconscious and your back brain, so to say, is consuming the architecture and gives you the real full feeling. This movie shows a little bit the spatial quality of this transformation into space from a sketch, from experiments into space. I don't make it too long. In Shenzhen, we used the robots as experiment in order to create a very complex figure you will see later. This is the space program. Two big exhibition rooms are under one roof. They call it the architectural museum. They call it planning exhibition platforms. And on the other side, there is a really exhibition box, enormous dimension, which houses contemporary art. And in between, there is a cloud, which we developed. This is the urban strategy, how we came, and this is the internal strategy. We wanted to make a three-dimensional Chinese garden, creating spots where you can walk by to see under the art or under the architecture. You have different experiences, not only the point of view in eye height. The cloud of experience is concerned with my favorite sculpture. This is Brancusi, or like the people there say, Brancusi. And from this form, we developed this cloud of knowledge, and we build it, and this is how it looks like. Outside, of course, we used digital tools. We used every tool we had at hand at this time. It's done with BIM as well. But the main thing, actually the north facade is different from the south facade. We are cooperating always with daylight, because daylight is very important not to get tired if you walk through these big spaces. This is the entrance, exhibition hall, the cloud of knowledge, a lot of levels, bridges. Yeah, this is like a reference to Frank Lloyd Wright, House on the Waterfall, and the many other experiences. You see the bridge, you see the crossing, you see the stairs. So you can look at this, not only the space, you can look at the exhibition from different levels. You see how big it is. And this is the last dance of the architect. I was explaining to the client what happens there. And then we thought, okay, now before we started to build it, I thought, okay, not Lyon again. We want to have robots to build this cloud of knowledge. And a Chinese company calculated not to do it by hand, so to say, would have 90 workers, 9 months. In this case, it took 9 people, 1 month. And even the welding is done. And even cleaning the seams is perfectly done. Anyway, so this is our office, and a little bit the danger of the developing this new method. This is our office now, and maybe in 10 years it will look like this. Another example is that it's a little church in my hometown, and we decided to do a small, the commission was to do a small chapel there. We took the geometry of a medieval roof, transported it by scripting this geometry into our times. We did a model, and the model was folded also by hand. All these things are a combination of scripting, 3D model, and a hand model where we changed the shape as well. Then we put it back in the computer. This is our new method to. It was done 1,000 miles from this small town away in Germany. The roof came in parts to the building site. They welded it together and then they put it up on the building. Since this is a little church, the music is Stairways to Heaven. Almost like a robot, huh? Ready-made roof. So this is how it looks like on the right hand. Maybe you can see the old Baroque tower, church tower, and the new chapel tower, or the new roof looks different, but it's connected somehow. But the building was not that easy because the roof was also the light tubes were coming down through the ceiling as well. We had to make we took a very old method to build it. It was done like this with raw. Look, because this was the way we could get very sharp edges. And these are the references for this church and for this coming through things. You know, Mies van der Rohe has a wall and just took the roof banal on the wall. Corbusier made the next step. He introduced a joint of light. You can see it here, and the roof is a reference because this was when I saw it the first time in 1968. I thought, if this is architecture, I really want to be an architect. But the difference between Corbusier and this one is that our light tubes come to the inside as well. And even the altar was done by the same geometry. The other thing is we introduced other design methods as well. This is a project for a temporary opera building. And we thought we have to build it in lightweight structure. Lightweight structures are not good for acoustics. So we introduced a shape for this volume, which keeps the sound from the outside away so that you have a very quiet space inside. And then we introduced music in order to create the peaks we need to absorb the sound from the outside. On the one side, it's purple haze. Constitutes the size of the peaks. And Mozart gave the direction. So music as a design tool is a very important aspect in our work, I have to say, because I like music very much. And the other thing, this is how it looks like, a lightweight structure. You can dismantle it very quickly and build it on another space as well. And the other thing, the other project was the project for the rock and roll, the extension of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in your country. And I have to say that, you know, the solo of Keith Richard in this music piece, I tried to copy it for years and I never ever could find the right sound. I changed the amplifiers, I changed the pickups and things. I never can do it until I heard the story I just told you that the neck was broken doing the last sound. But what we can do for this, we could analyze the lick of Keith Richard and make a building out of it. So the other thing was, music as a tool of exploring new shapes and new forms in architecture. Now, since we are far more advanced, as you can see, I'm not drawing on paper anymore. I'm sitting there and I'm drawing sketches, as you can see. But the advantage is that I can see the sketch in three dimensions. I'm not able to do it to sketch three-dimensional. It will be able to do so very soon. We are working on that. There are tools I can do that. So this is a project for a small museum for a steel company. And the most fascinating thing is that we now can close our office and can work via this tool, working on a model, put it in the three dimension, put it in this meeting room, and then we can work not only being as avatars in this space, we can work on the model and look at the model like I want to see it. Because a model for me is the only language I can use to create a three-dimensional, to understand the three-dimensional power of this project, because you know, architecture is a three-dimensional language and you have to speak it three-dimensional. And we build physical models in order to get a grip on the model. Das heißt, in German, it means begreifen, and that means to touch it and to understand it. Now I'm in the thing. I think Daniel should do this lecture. I'm just giving it. If you want to know something about deep Himmelblau, ask Daniel, because he's working on this since how long? How long are you working on this with Caroline?
Almost 2017, 2018.
Yeah, yeah. So he put all our projects into the brain in our thing. But I have to say, and this is a skeptical approach to this artificial intelligence. This slide comes from a friend, Wolf Singer, who is a neuroscientist who is working on that since years, and he is also comparing city planning with the structure of our brain. We are doing a project with him in this on this level, and he compares the biggest computer with the brain of a fly. And what he says, the big computer, he can, if he would be able to dream, he would dream to be able to do what the fly is doing with their brain, because she can making in milliseconds decision this computer is not able to do so. Anyway, so now we are in the universe of Coop Himmelblau. I really liked it. How many, I said, Daniel, you said 100,000 pictures are in this universe.
And yes, right now 100, is,
Yeah, 100,000, yeah. And if you get closer, you see that all our projects are into this artificial intelligence. What I'm missing and what should be the next step is that we put all our plans and sections also in this universe in order to make it able. If we got the commission for an opera building, we say, okay, artificial intelligence, start to work and combine all our opera buildings in one building, and the whole office goes to a bar and drinks beer, and when we come back, the project is finished and we send it to the client. Later on, we will follow up with the PIM, and it will be buildable after 2 weeks. And when we deliver all our plans, we get the fee, and then we take our office to the Maldives and sitting there for 3 weeks, and everything is done. This is the future, in my point of view, of the artificial intelligence. All the other things are just playing around in an, on an academic level. This is what I had the discussion with Daniel many times. It could work, maybe. It will take longer than I'm thinking. And this is in our process of developing the project, the points where artificial intelligence will move in and will be later on very helpful to develop the projects. First, experiments, camera input, artificial intelligent output. This project, the camera input, this is an organized project. It's organized along the program. And what the artificial intelligent now is doing, he gives us idea how we can change the form, but that's not enough for me to believe what could be possible if we can work on the organization of the building as well, the same way we are doing it, just on the formal way. I like this, the colors on this building, because it reminds me on Francis Bacon very much so. Another project, bigger project one. It's always done with an organized model. And I want to have the organization also done by the artificial intelligence. So Daniel, you have to speed up a little bit, because if we can get there, we are happy not to work and let the artificial intelligence work. And then I would say, this is not artificial intelligence, it's still the architects which are intelligent, because we invented that. Comes close to the idea we have in mind. And when we have an organizational tool as well, and we interfere that, the organization will say, stop,
it's finished. Not we are saying that, the artificial intelligence, the tool will say, this is it, the future. And the clouds, sooner or later we can build this building, I'm sure. I like that because I just read it from John Culkin, and that I remember that Winston Churchill 60, 80 years ago said the same thing on another level. And maybe in 20 years, the lecture will start like that. Thank you so much. Hopefully no questions because I'm tired. I really would give it to Daniel, who can answer your question, which is, I'm sure, concerned with the workshop methods. He can do it much better than me.
Thank you, Mr. Prix. That was amazing. How many questions we can try to answer? Can we have at least 1, 2, 3 questions, something?
Yeah. I can answer. If I could answer the question, I will answer it. If not, I will delegate it to you.
Okay. So let's do it that way. So right now there are a few questions in the chat. So I'll ask you to, the students that have the question, you can unmute yourself and you can perhaps ask the question, yeah? Let's try to keep it very short, and like that in a way we can have multiple questions asked. So we are going to start with Catherine. If you are able to unmute yourself and ask the question.
Hi, how are you guys doing?
Hi, how are you?
Good. So I think you kind of answered my question a little bit. I was asking how you mentioned that it was your dream to be able to have a program to fly through the space instead of walking through it. But we've always been taught in school that renderings should be taken from like a person's view, eye view, because it kind of shows the experience someone will be having. So what would you say would be the advantage of being able to fly through the space versus walking through it?
Are you asking me or Daniel?
Not me, for
sure. Whoever has the answer.
Renderings are just lying. Renderings are not, they don't give you the real proofment whether the architecture is spatial or not. Renderings are only for stupid clients.
Gotcha. But I know you're talking about having a video walkthrough, like as in, you know, you're walking through the space, but you're saying you'd rather be able to like fly through the space. What exactly did you mean by that?
What? Say it again.
I know you were talking about having a video walkthrough as if someone's walking through the space, and you were saying you'd much more prefer to be able to fly through the space.
I'm not talking about the video walkthrough. You can do an animation, which is also lying if you walk through, because the real space feeling you have to experience by yourself when it's finished. Then you can prove whether you were right or not. I prefer to build models. The bigger, the better. Step by step, if you develop the project, we start with small models and getting bigger and bigger. And then we have this video conference models where I can talk to my guys when I'm at home. So we can talk on this virtual reality meeting room. But it's not the same like to look on the model by when you can it
take and turn it around and things like that. Because the screen makes distance. Yeah, like this lecture is a very distancing communication. Because if I would be there, I would be able to see how you react and you see how I explain what I want to explain. You never ever can see that on the screen. Because basically, look at my eyes. I'm looking at the camera upside. I never can look in your eyes. And this is, I experienced that two days ago on Sunday. We had problems with our Russian projects because it was for them that it was not clear what we wanted to do. We went there and explained it on a table where we can sit a person, look at their eyes and communicate. And these problems were solved in 2 hours. So we can use all these tools and we should use it as a tool, but not as a demanding tool. What I can see how students are working, designing the projects. They are playing around on a 3D model only on the screen. It's a big difference if you do that planning on the screen and make a model, then you can prove whether this is what the screen says or the rendering says it's true or not. If you have the experience, I have to say.
Yeah, absolutely.
This is, I think, to combine all the tools, namely physical model, 3D model, virtual reality, if you combine them, this will be the next step. Like the television didn't kill the cinema. The simultaneity of systems is the future of our world.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you. So there's another question from Diana Bash. If you can unmute yourself and ask the question. Okay, do you want me? I'm going to read the question then, okay? So in a 2013 interview, you used the analogy of a person sitting on a branch, sawing the branch off to describe the state of the power dynamics the architect currently possesses. You lamented that the architect has all the responsibility, but less and less power with time. What powers will you advocate for architects to have that you believe they don't have today?
I said that we architects are sitting on the branch and sawing on the branch, not with a saw, but with a motor saw, meaning that we are losing power against the prohibiting forces we have to face every day, meaning the politics, meaning the clients, meaning the project manager, meaning the evaluation guys. We have to get power back by demanding that we are the experts and we know what they don't know because we can understand the space, reading the plans, reading the model, and you, client, have to trust me. So this, no, you have to trust us. You know, I'm 40 years doing, or 50 years doing architecture. I have experience you will never get. You never know, will know what I am experienced and what I am intending to do. So the problem with our project at the first glimpse, when we show the things, everyone says, oh, it's so complicated. You can't do it. And I don't know whether it's worth. When we get through with this project like Mocape, yeah, everyone is happy. Everyone is impressed by the kind of Borromini stuff we are developing. At the background, you can see here is one of the details of the Mocape Museum. So what we have to do in the future, in order to get back the power we had 100 years ago, we have to develop swarm intelligence. You know, now we are so many architects in the, like swimming like sardines in the pool of sharks. So for the client, it's easy to bite one out of this swarm because we architects have no swarm intelligence. Everyone believes he is the better one. In order to overcome and get back the power, we have to unite in a not in an academic sense, but in a political sense. So this is the answer to your complicated question.
Okay, can I follow up here with another question, personal curiosity? So I think one of the challenges that many architects face is this aspect of you're starting with an amazing idea, and then you are faced with this kind of like budget and then project deadlines and client and politics and regulations and so on. And then at the end of the process, they end up, instead of having that kind of amazing sketch that they started with, they end up with a project that is very watered down in a way. So in your experience, how is Coop Himmelb able to maintain in a way that kind of initial quality that you have in the sketch when you are starting to design?
We always said that you cannot fight 100 tanks with one tank. You have to develop other weapons in order to overcome the 100 tanks, meaning you have to invent the bazooka. The same thing in architecture. You have to invent strategy to make every disadvantage, to turn this seemingly disadvantage to an advantage. Like we said, okay, if the rule is, you have to, hinterfragen means, you have to look behind the scene and look how, what the reason is, why does people asking for this solution and not going with our solution. And by checking that out, maybe you can develop the idea to getting through with your idea. For instance, this rooftop, which I think was the first so-called deconstructivist building, we only could go through with it by saying it's art. We could persuade the mayor that is not a conventional rooftop extension. Then if this would be a rooftop, a conventional architectural rooftop extension, we had to follow the material, we had to follow the slope of the roof and things. By saying it's art and could persuade that the mayor gives the stamp on it, we could build it. So all right. This is just an example how to overcome people. And we always ask, why should we do it that way? Okay, money. Okay, what is, like the cloud in Mocape. much too expensive. We can do that, blah, 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 blah. Then we found a Chinese company who could do it. Usually they are doing submarines and cars. They could do it cheaper. And on the other hand, the budget, we could keep the budget in Lyon by introducing this turbulence column, because it's a very intelligent, the structural engineer, my friend Bollinger, is intelligent and we are intelligent by to invent a new kind of structure. There are only this one color supports the whole glass cube, the lobby, the glass structure, glass and steel structure, reduces the weight of the steel 1/3. So therefore the budget comes down 1/3. So these are some examples for strategy, how we are acting. We don't believe every code. We don't believe we don't, at the first glimpse, we don't take the program as given. So we have to analyze what the client wants and how we can do it better and cheaper and more iconic. I have to say, you know, when we built BMW, they calculated 800,000 visitors per year. And we said, okay, if we do it more iconic, there will be more visitors. And they say, oh, we'll see, okay, we'll see. Now they have 3 million a year instead of 800,000. And if we calculate what we are doing now in order to prove that this kind of architecture is attractive to people, because people are loving, without knowing it, they experience the space in a very comfortable way. So that creates an atmosphere, an open arm atmosphere, so to say.
Okay, so following up on this idea, so mostly we are talking then about we have to turn disadvantage into advantages. We have to develop very smart strategies that in a way overcome these kind of challenges. Yeah, and yeah. It's getting us ahead in a way. So here there is a question that follows very closely with this. A student is asking, how do you see the practical application of artificial intelligence in architectural field evolving in the next 20, 30 years? And maybe we can address it in connection to this kind of like, we have this kind of challenges. So can we use maybe artificial intelligence to help us come up with better solutions, with smarter solutions, the same way that we try to avoid or to turn disadvantage into advantages?
I think the advantage of the artificial intelligence could be that we architects get more intelligent. Meaning introducing not only that, like we discussed, Daniel, you know, introducing not other kind of Gestalt. Yeah, you understand Gestalt?
Yes.
Other kind of synthesis of program and form, but but also develop the organization of the building. If this would be able, we have to take care that not the big offices are taking all these advantages, and we poor guys are sitting there and working for big offices by using the computer and designing some details. This is the danger, like PIM. The PIM was done, I know this was developed also by Frank Gehry and his crew, in order to make more architecture, develop more architecture in
in an economic way. I would like to, I don't know, is der Jan noch da? Er soll bitte kommen. I show an example. Yeah? Next question, okay. Meanwhile.
Manos, Professor Vermiso, you have a question, if you want to ask the question.
Yes, I do. Good evening, Mr. Prix, and thank you for a great lecture. In the light of the discussion that we are having about AI, and I know that Daniel will be tempted to answer this, but I would like to hear your thoughts on that particular aspect, because you spoke about the unconscious in the beginning of the presentation. So my question is that current machine learning methods for architecture usually interpolate between data that comes from existing ideas and projects. Do you think this is a limitation that excludes the possibility for reaching the kind of unconscious moment you mentioned, the one that guides our creative processes?
This project?
I'm sorry, I'm here. Wait. Interrupted. I'm sorry. The subconscious and?
I was talking about, you mentioned that the fact that there is this important unconscious moment within any kind of creative process when a writer is creating, a writing or a musician is composing, and I guess it extends to the designer. And because our current AI methods rely on interpolating between data sets, which rely on data on things that we already produced, on ideas which already exist. Do you think this is a limitation that negates the possibility for transcending that kind of process and reaching the unconscious moment that you described earlier?
Well, I'm in discussion with my friend, the neuroscientist. We discussing that all the time. And he sent me the picture of the fly and the big computer. He's saying that it will take another 100 years to get there, that is, we can break the distance between the machine and the human being, so that we can, the machine could develop a subconscious as well. I don't think that if the machine is learning the shapes and the plans, if the machine is learning that and combining it, that new development will come up. But I have to say, this is not my problem, because this is your problem in the next 30 years, not my problem. Yeah. What I wanted to show is how methods are changing. In my architectural life, we started with a pen. Yeah. Now I'm drawing on the 3D program and trying to develop the things. I'm not sure, I have to say, because it's very recently I did that for the newest project. I made the drawing, and turned it around, and I will try to make a three-dimensional drawing. I don't know. I have to say, I don't know. I really will, maybe in 2-3 years, I can answer that, whether this is the same feeling I developed at the same when I'm drawing a drawing. I have no idea. I don't know. Every advantage has a disadvantage, I have to say, and the faster we are, maybe we are in danger that other people, building industry, is taking over our jobs. Yeah. Is that understandable, or?
Yes, perfectly.
Is this answering your question?
Yes, it is. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. So we'll have to wrap up soon. So probably I'll just ask two more questions. because we are already 2 hours almost in, or 1 hour and a half in, and also it's late for Mr. Prix. So one question which mostly hits at the core of Coop Himmelb is, what is about the cloud that inspires your design process and overall practice?
Say it again.
So what is it about the cloud that inspires your design process and overall practice?
You mean when we started our office, Himmelblau? Yeah. Oh, yeah, long story. Do you see the pyramid?
Yes.
Yeah. See, this, this, everyone sees that as icon of architecture. Look at the program. A very small program. But this program has a meaning that excuses all these black architectural parts, so to say. If you go nowadays to a client, let's say, who wants to build apartments, and tell them, okay, I'm building a pyramid like that. It's an icon. It's very marketing, good marketing for you. And these are the apartments. He will kill you immediately. You have lost the project in less than 3 minutes. Why did they do it? Because this is a transformer from life to eternity. So if we have a great program, the program asks for architecture, then you have to go for it. However you can explore this kind of architecture. What Himmelblau, therefore I called the lecture the Himmelblau project, because it's very personal. It's not the only way we can do architecture, but this is one way. Yeah. Like I said, everyone is right, but nothing is correct. So this is what I always say. If we can prove that it's worth to make architecture out of the program, then maybe you are able to convince even the most stupid guys. And if your arguments, your verbal arguments are not enough, then you have to do a rendering. And if this is not enough, you have to do an animation, then they are happy.
Okay, so can we also address this question of what is it about the cloud, the idea of clouds, that it's inspired for?
Cloud. You know, I love to read Shakespeare, and my favorite piece is Hamlet. And you know why I love and why I always compare our architecture with Shakespeare pieces? Because not one drama of Shakespeare is a one-liner. Hamlet as a one-liner, as a box in translated into architecture, would read, the ghost appears, Hamlet kills himself, and that's the end. So this would be a box. If you want to translate the whole story of Ophelia, the father and the mother and Polonius and things like that into architecture, it comes close to architecture of Corbusier, of Kiesler, of the Baroque architecture and so forth. It will never be a box, never ever. And in this Hamlet piece, there is a dialogue from Hamlet and Polonius where Hamlet says, oh, look at this cloud. it looks like a crocodile. Yes, my prince, was the answer. No, and then he said, oh, it changes to, I forgot this other thing. So I thought, okay, why should we always be influenced by the existing space? Why don't the room not change according to our desires? This was the point of departure of our things. And when he was, when Daniel was at the introduction said that we are experimenting with actions and things, it was always concerned to improve the flexibility of architecture. Like the feedback spaces we did. We constructed a space which was changing according the heartbeat. It was growing up and inflatable thing. And you can see and hear the heartbeat. Yeah, so you can go into your own body and influencing the heartbeat by the visible heartbeat by concentration and things like that. It was always our dream. I know it's not, you know, when we started to think about that we can build big space with various stories inside this space by ramps and bridges and not flat, but sculptured ceilings, which influences people going through in a certain way we thought that we will be able, when we started it, I think we were thinking about Leo or the Mokape building in a different way, but the same concept. And I was very happy to be there, as you could see that I was almost dancing when I explained the building to the mayor of Shenzhen. I thought, okay, this is it, what we dreamed 40 years ago. And to leave out columns will be the next step. And the next step will be no gravity in our buildings. You can fly around. I will not. Maybe I will not, in my life, I will not experience that, but I'm sure that the tools you guys are developing now, the artificial intelligence or however the tools are called, that could be the next step in creating this kind of architecture. What I see, or what I could see is a flashback to a very conservative approach to architecture. And this architect's excusing their not being enough, not having enough fantasy to explore it in a different way. They say it's social and we have to take care of our environment, blah, blah, blah. This is a conservative approach, and I think we have to overcome that because otherwise we will die because of being bored so much.
All right, so that's amazing. So we have one final question and then we'll have to wrap it up. Yulia, if you want to ask your question, Yulia Fomina, if you can unmute yourself.
Okay, I am here.
Yeah, perfect.
Can you hear me?
I can see you.
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah, okay.
My question is about unconsciousness. How would you describe it? Is it erratic and spontaneous or intuitive and leaning towards some logic?
You have to ask a psychoanalyst to answer this question.
I think you mentioned that it's one of your tools. So for you as an architect, does it help you to liberate yourself
I explain it in a very architectural way. Okay. If you are making a drawing, you are thinking about the upcoming project, and you are drawing a line and then another line like this. You say, okay, but I want to make this. I show you, okay. And at the same, yeah, if you're drawing, where is it? Yeah, this kind of plan. And while drawing it, you are thinking, oh, I can do it. It's too expensive. Oh, I can do it. The client will not like it. Oh, I can do it because it's not enough greenwashed. No, I can do it because it's too much concrete, which is unhealthy. Oh, I can do it because I cannot do it in wood. So this is consciousness is ruling you, the attitude of how people will like you, make you be obedient in advance. And what we said, if we could overcome these constraints and making it possible and drawing it without thinking about that, the drawing obviously comes not from the logic, but it comes from your hand, which is connected to your brain, and not visually and not rational, because there was an exhibition, Holland did it long time ago at the Biennale. The architect is a seismograph of the future, yeah? And yeah, this is the explanation in an architectural way. We are suffering on this architectural attitude, being obedient in advance, and to and you have verinnerlichter Zwang. I cannot translate it. I'm sorry. That the being obedient in advance is that you always think you cannot do it because it's not allowed, instead of thinking, okay, this is what I want to do, and I try to do it. Understandable?
Yeah, so I think here, I'm just going to start to wrap this up. So I think also dP Himmelblau is touching a bit on this kind of idea, like how we are challenging our conventional way of thinking, how we challenge that kind of way of, we are looking at something, you have already a way of looking and interpreting those things. So how can you challenge that? And I think in Coop Himmelb, this is what it's amazing, is that you engage in these kind of processes that they are not necessarily linear. They are not necessarily just one sort of process, but you have this kind of multiple processes that operate at different levels, and you are trying to challenge design at multiple levels. Yeah, not only you have one tool that generates everything. Yeah,
this is feedback.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And Mr. Prix, you are describing this also like Barcelona, like rule, like how you have in a way this kind of breaking of the game. So you have this kind of triangle game in a way between players, and then you have a fourth player that comes in and breaks in a way that rule. And here, I think it's the same kind of issue with architecture. You're always falling into this kind of habitual patterns of designing. And the idea is then how do you break those patterns all the time, yeah? So I think this discussion is amazing. Reminds me of being in the office. It's 6:00 PM. I'm about to go home. Mr. Prix passed by, and then suddenly we end up in a super long discussion, like 3-4 hours discussions. So yeah, this is amazing. Unfortunately, we'll have to wrap it up because there are also some classes that students have to attend to. So Mr. Prix, I don't think words can express how much we appreciate you being here. So we thank you a lot. Yeah, I think it was amazing. And I think many students found like a lot of insights about how to think about architecture and the role of them as architects in this society. So thank you once again.
Thank you very much. And Mr. Vermisso, I liked your question very much because I don't know the answer.
Neither do we.
Thank you. Bye, guys.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Mr. Prix.
Bye.
Bye, everyone. Bye.